this is a workshop for commercial users, right? So I think we should talk a little bit about the commercial aspect. If you look at the mobile market, you see that the numbers are pretty strikingly high. You have lots of users, just about everybody in the world uses mobile devices, about half of them are fairly recent devices. You have an extraordinary amount of money being generated in this industry. In fact, it's the largest growing industry on the planet. We have over $1 trillion per year invested and rotated in mobile markets. And that also means that there's a lot of opportunities, for example, in advertising, in building applications for mobiles, etc., etc. If you just split out from the projection of something like $9 billion spent on writing mobile applications, if you split one third, roughly what is about the data traffic and all the voice traffic going through these applications, and we are still talking about $3 billion yearly on applications that you guys can put on your phone, download them from your app store or whatever. $3 billion, that's a fairly significant amount of money, but it's even better than that because it's projected to triple for the next year. So we're looking at over $10 billion, or around $10 billion spent on your applications, which is a pretty darn good amount of money. So there are lots of opportunities, so this is a good segment to be in. However, currently, this is some statistics I took from the website. I can see that on the bottom. There's a link, you can find it in my media later. So basically, there are three different ways of reaching people using the mobile devices. You can have websites that are browsable using these mobile devices, and you can have different applications. And just as a comparison, I split out the iPhone application, and I maintain another category, which basically tries to develop mobile applications for the major brands, including iOS, Android, Windows Phone, Windows Mobile. So if any company ventures out into writing a mobile application, they probably want to have multiple platforms, unfortunately. That's just the way it goes. You're looking at spending about $90,000. That's a fairly reasonable figure, you might say. However, if you look at the percentage of people you can reach, I think you can see that, for example, iPhones are about one-fourth or a little less of the major brands. Looking at 6.75% of the reach, which is fairly reasonable. However, compared to the mobile website, which roughly costs them about the same amount of money, but it reaches a lot more people. So you may ask yourself, is it really worth developing a mobile application? Well, we'll see later on. So just remember these figures. So the highest turnaround is really, or the highest rate of return of investment in a mobile website, you're reaching about 3,000 people per dollar spent. That's not too bad. However, mobile applications are getting old. And as we can see, we can actually combine the two. So we'll talk about that just in a second. But let's look at the If it was already changed, what things would be exciting to you? What would be exciting? And I just put up a few things that would excite me. For example, if I could write less code to get an application running, that would be pretty cool. Maybe I wouldn't have to learn the complex APIs that some of these platforms have, that would be kind of cool. What would be really cool is if I could use high level abstractions. Typically, we're talking about abstractions for functional programming. It would really, really be awesome if you had a type-safe, sort of declarative style UI that I just define a few lines of code and then have some kind of tool generate the code for me. What would really be the best is if I could do multi-targeting and just write the code once and have it targeted to different platforms. And then, you know, just some goodies at the end. It would be really nice to actually scale it to desktop applications. It used to be the other way around, so we started out with desktop applications. Like a company like Microsoft would say, hey, here's Word. How can you put Word on a mobile device? And you know, that's an interesting problem. Nowadays, it's actually going the other way. We have these interesting web applications, but the operating systems running on desktop machines are becoming more like these mobile devices. So soon you will have multi-touch laptops and you know all kinds of things running Windows 8 and things like that. So there's this move backwards. Say, you're now trying to get mobile applications back into the desktop, which you can, I guess, call less mobile devices. And it would be also nice to actually scale it to the cloud. So as you will see, I'm going to talk about something today that actually addresses all of this, which I think is actually quite cool. And I hope you will do the same too. And overall, this will give you a tremendous saving on all kinds of effort. It will cut down on development time. It will cut down on time to market, because of that, you will have, because of the lot less code, you will have a lot more maintainability. So overall, it will be less support, and you will have a quicker return investment. So that's the business talk. So now, let's move on to some technicalities. So we mentioned, remember the first chart about the mobile applications and mobile websites, with a 1-to-3 ratio in the cost, and the mobile websites reaching more people? And I said, well, we can actually combine this. So we can now, this is actually the tendency nowadays. All of these mobile devices and mobile platforms are incorporating the idea of being able to provide native-like mobile applications for their actual websites packaged into a shell, which is running on these devices. And in that, basically, there's this movement that is aiming to sort of, probably not purposely, but it's just happening this way. So JavaScript is becoming the intermediate language. It's already the intermediate language of the client-side web applications. Every website pretty much has some kind of client-side code and it's executing in JavaScript. But it's also becoming the intermediate language for desktop applications. I don't know if you have followed Windows 8 announcements. You can now write native Windows applications in HTML and JavaScript. So they have leveled the .NET and IR code and the JavaScript, which is actually an interesting idea. And of course, it's also becoming nowadays the intermediate language for mobile applications, like I said. So basically, it seems like JavaScript is all over the place. In fact, some people are even doing server-side development, Node.js, etc. All right, so we basically can conclude that now it's maybe a good idea to start developing applications in JavaScript. Okay, there are lots of technologies, including Foga. sharper, NAND that sharper, you can actually get away compared to other frameworks, or even compared to just standard technologies like ASP.NET or mobile development technologies. You will end up writing a lot less, up to half, but typically 90% savings. So you're maybe writing 10-15% of the code base that you're talking about. So that's an enormous saving, which means it's much quicker to develop as well. And also, so then we built onto this framework what we call WebSharp Mobile, which is a small layer between the acting web application and the mobile devices. So it basically exposes mobile capabilities to JavaScript. It provides all the necessary packaging, so you can actually get Android packages or Windows Phone packages without doing anything. There's tooling that does all that work for you. And it basically enables what we talked about as something that is badly needed, this multi-targeting feature. You write the code once and you can either target it to Android, you can target it to Windows Phone or any other mobile device. And, like we will talk about it at the very, very end, it's scaled into the cloud because it provides seamless tooling and infrastructure to take your server side if you have not done it and scale it out into the cloud. There's all kinds of extensions, like I said, available. So let's talk about these powerful abstractions that I mentioned. And probably all of you know Fieldwork. This is so much work he has done. But one of the things that came out of his research with these formats several years ago. And WebSharper was actually one of the first web frameworks to incorporate formats. So these formats, what they give you, they give you a type statement composed of web abstraction. They give you basically first class forms. So you can have functions that compute forms, functions that take forms and mutate them or enhance them in certain ways. That's, it would be better to put it that way. We have also added dependent formats, which can express dependencies. And we also have a notion called controllers, which provides a step-by-step layout alongside the wizard that walks through a series of type-safe steps that carry certain values from step one to the next. Here's an example. On the top, you see a function TV, which stands for text box. It takes a label and a message, and it will create an input text box. It will enhance the validator that checks for emptiness. And if it's empty, it will keep saying, no, 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 you can't pass this before yellow. And it will give the message. And we also enhance it with the validation icon, so we get some visual indication that the control is in a failing state. And then we also enhance it with the label that we specify. So this will give you a label and we'll give you a text box, but the text box will already have client side validation. And it takes 5 lines of code in WebSharp. And down there in the bottom half, you will see a general pattern of how formats are combined. So this is a function format.yield. Which takes another function which packages all the values that we get from the composed subformats that are stored and joined in onto that expression. So we can take n formats, n subformats, and what we get back from the function is whatever that function returns as you compose those v sub I. So here's an example. We have a type that carries or packages the notion of what is a user or a person. It has, let's say, a name and an email. So the person format will return a format of person. Hopefully you guys are all familiar with the F-sharp notation. So that's just the standard way of saying that format is a parameterizable type. It is parameterized over a type called person. So we basically construct two text boxes, name F and email F, and then we combine them. And then from the yield function we return a record type or a record value of type person. Back to the user, but visually, before we do that, we enhance with submit and reset buttons. We enhance with a legend, which will put a little box around the whole control, and it will also enhance with the form container, which will wrap some nice CSS around the whole thing. So all that, whatever, 10 or 15 lines, will get you that form. So you have visual indication of the failing state. If you start typing the name, the red cross will immediately can solve it with the buttons, and as you can see, the solving is actually grayed out because some controls are in failure. So that's what you get from the 10 lines of code here, which basically, as I would say, as concise and abstract as it gets. If you're interested about, okay, how do I change the layout? How do I talk in presentation the layer details, like let's change the, you know, the look and feel and everything. That can all be controlled from CSS. Or you can decide to override some of these format controls in alternate HTML and CSS representation, or even annotate the additional client-side functionality that we'll be executing in JavaScript. You can do all that fairly easily, so it's not any problem. Let me flip back to the assignments here. This is a section I asked here. So assignments next to formats is the other major format or abstraction that we use at Sharper. They're basically pretty much the same concept. It's a time-saving composable abstraction for websites. So I can take a website, I can represent it in a time-saving way, I can have two websites, compose them, etc., etc. And the only thing you have to know is that it's parameterized over a union type. This is what gives the type safety. So if I have an action type which enumerates all the different functionalities that a website can provide, or my website can provide, you're not handling any of the compiled warning or error, depending on your settings. So that's how we make sure that it's all type safe. So here I'm saying that I have a website which will have its own action type called action, and it will have a home, contact, protected, and a login page, which actually takes another action. And note how you can have arbitrary values tagged onto these shapes, and a logout and an echo. So let's just take some examples. So I can take some XML. We have a templating language. And the templating language has some placeholder. And placeholders become actually typed functions. F-sharp code will be generated from these templates. For example, if you take an XML that sort of you get from your designer, and you basically add it to your project as a template, it will show up as an F-sharp file, which gets generated in the background, and it will provide you with that function called templates.skin. It will happen to be called skin, if it's a skin.xml, skin.template.xml, too. And you will get a function inside of that called skin, which will act as the function that will take all the different placeholder values, and then we'll instantiate it into an actual page. So here we're fulfilling, as you can see, there are six placeholders in the template in this contrived example, the banner, menu, and main, and sidebar, and footer, and whatever. So that lower half constructs the page for us with the six placeholders plugged in, so to say. One of the things we're plugging in, for example, is a menu. And the menu is above, as you can see, defined above, which basically just plugs in a bunch of A tags wrapped in a label. So you can see the HTML combinators appearing in the code. I don't really want to do this, but it's actually not that difficult. And I define just a short convenience function to the back, which takes an action and gives me a link to it. This is the type safe. So it's just a safe URL. Type safe URL or something different. So that function template will construct a page for me with all the placeholders filled out. And I can just actually have another module that defines my pages using the template function. For example, here's the home page. We take the template, and the only thing that needs to be instantiated is the home main content, where we put a simple h1 and a link that goes to the contact page, and note how I can actually get a safe URL to that page. And so let's see how you compose site. So let's say I have a very simple site that acts as the root of my application. It basically corresponds to the action home, and it will be served as the pages.home page. And then we simply say that it's served from the root of the application. There's another site, but this is actually an inferred one. As you can see in the previous example, I use a splash to indicate the root of the application. I don't have to really do that. I can infer the whole URL space if I want from the action type. And in this case, you will basically map actions to pages. Content can be anything. It can be arrow code, it can be XML, it can be whatever. So these pages or contact page, etc., have been defined using the template function I just showed, so they all will become pages. And some will respond to actions, like the logout action will log you out and then redirect you to the home page. It's all timed. decide, hey, I actually want to use the UI controls to render my folder. Or no, I want to use XJS, which is another popular library. Or no, I'm actually working on mobile devices, so I want to have jQuery mobile, for example, to give me the kind of loop that I would expect from a mobile device. So for example, let's take the format extensions for jQuery mobile, and then let's write some format. This is the format I'm not going to go through it. It's actually a flowlet, as you can see in the bottom. It will have two steps, each let bank. Actually, the one let bank will be the two bank, which will be the second step. So what we do is we construct a single form that will actually, as you can see, pick a username, a password, and it will have a checkbox, whether you want to be logged in or kept logged in or not. And then we take all the information from the format, and then we output something on the second step, basically a div with a header that says welcome, whoever. And then we will not overload the memory.
kind of a question that would allow us to get most of the problem. There are inevitably people who need to possibly all your individual apps can really be great. How would you push that to the idea?
Yeah, so basically webshop and mobile has two layers. One is a generic layer that basically is functionality that we expect all the different mobile platforms to provide, such as accelerometer data, GPS data, camera access, things like that. That's the basic stuff. And then we have platform-specific functionalities exposed, such as communication channel, Bluetooth, USB, whatever. Those are per technology. So if you ever write code that uses those technologies, you will be pinned already to that one platform. Now, it may be that the other platform also gives you the same kind of capability, but the API may be different. So if you change the namespace in your file, then you will find out. Because it says, oh, well, now there's a compiler error because you're trying to use Bluetooth, but actually it's not supported to the kind of parameters that you supply on that other platform, in the previous platform. So now all you do is just change. So basically, the compiler pinpoints you only the places that you need to change, and then you have all the targets.
And is there a way to factor out the
you can build abstractions that do that. So, for example, we started providing this support in a generic way, basically discovering what device we were running on, and this catching function calls these platform-specific functions in a manner that either succeeded or not. So you could write an application that assumed nothing about the actual target platform, but it assumed that it has, you know, camera capabilities, etc., etc., and you ran it, and then runtime it said, sorry, but this is an application that requires camera capabilities, and you don't appear to have one. That's the approach we took. And then we decided that, okay, it's probably best not to delay finding that out, so that we should do that decision early on. So we just moved the API into the